Welcome to Insight, produced in partnership with RSUTV at Rogers State University in Oklahoma. Today, we are chatting with Dr. Larry Rice, president of Rogers State University, who has generously agreed to share some of his experience with us. I'd like to thank you, Dr. Rice, for joining us today.
You're welcome. It's a privilege to meet you and a privilege to be here.
Well, it's my privilege, and it's my privilege to be at Rogers State University, an institution that looms large in this area. It is an economic driver. It is a driver of opportunity. It is a place of community. Talk about Rogers State University, its history, its founding, and its direction going forward.
We were part of the statehood agreement. If you go back, Oklahoma statehood was in 1907. And shortly thereafter, as a part of the agreement, there was two preparatory schools built here in eastern Oklahoma, which was formerly called Indian Territory. The construction was started in 1909, and we opened as a high school preparatory school. And we were a preparatory school until 1917. There was a little political squabble, and the governor vetoed the funding. So in 1917, they ceased as Eastern University Preparatory School. But 2 years later, we reopened as Oklahoma Military Academy. And if you know your history, in 1918, World War I was ending and had ended. And so in 1919, it was a good time to start a military academy. So we began a long 52-year history as a military academy, 4 years of high school, 2 years of college. And we were a military academy until 1971. So then after 1971, we were a community college for many years. And ultimately in 1998, late 99, we received accreditation to open our doors as a regional baccalaureate institution. So in 2000, we opened our doors to four-year students and graduated our first class in 2002. So you might say we're about almost 20 years old. So we're rather new in the regional baccalaureate, but we've been on this hill since 1909 and very much a fabric and part of this community, as well as we have a branch campus in Bartlesville and a branch campus in the Mid-American Industrial Park in Pryor. So we have three very diverse locations, but we have one mission, and that's to prepare our students for either a local or a global education. And today it's best to prepare for a global, because we really don't know where our students are going to end up.
So you have a 100-year history and a 20-year existence in this form, but really the form has changed because the times have changed.
Yes.
People's needs have changed.
Yes.
And the need for educated Oklahomans, educated young people has just evolved to this global world.
You're absolutely correct. And one of the things I like to point out, there's a lot of great higher education institutions in the Tulsa metro area, but we're the only public supported higher education school that you can live on campus and have a traditional college experience. So we have a very blended population. About half of our students are the typical 18-year-old. The other half, they're in the 25 to 50 range. So they're coming back for career changes or lifestyle changes or a variety of, you know, sometimes it's from an occupational injury. And
this is so important because you are actually running as a nonprofit social good business. So you have customers.
Yes.
You have customers with particular needs, with a particular shape in their lives. You're actually shaping who you are according to those needs.
Absolutely. And we really believe that we're impacting generational poverty. There's a lot of poverty in Oklahoma, and particularly eastern Oklahoma. And so we're one of the few four-year degree-granting institutions in northeast Oklahoma. There's others, but we serve a unique population. So 67% of our students are first in their family to go to school. 75% of them have to have financial aid, and 80% of them work. But on any given year, 49 to 50% will graduate debt-free. We truly are impacting regional poverty, the first in the family issues, and so hopefully someday we'll get beyond that statistic of even 10% first in their family going to school.
One of the things that I find so fascinating is this idea of shaping programs around the needs of a region. Too often in the past, these programs have been shaped elsewhere and imported into regions where the fit was not right, but
right.
There was a message that was delivered that we know best.
Yes.
And and you should follow what we know. And I think what's happening is that communities are taking back that space.
You're absolutely correct, and I think higher ed has been guilty in the past of saying, "Come to us." You know, we're the mecca of knowledge. But higher education, as you know, is changing, and we have to change as well, both in Oklahoma and around it, as well as the United States. And so we try to meet that job market. We're looking at ways to partner with other institutions. We do a lot of high school concurrent enrollment. That's important. There's a lot of pressure today to offer up to 60 hours in to the college for college credit for high schools. And so that's a big part of what we do. But it also lets the rural students or the ones that may have a question whether they're college material, but it lets them build some confidence to enroll in the concurrent enrollment. And one of our campuses is close to their home. Sometimes we offer it in the high school, but we like for them to come on campus and kind of get a taste and to kind of get some assurance that they can, you know, go to college. Myself is a good example. No one encouraged me to go to school. Neither one of my parents. My parents encouraged me, but they did not have a high school education. And so,
what did your parents do?
Well, my mother was a traditional stay-at-home mother, and my dad was a skilled construction worker. He a cement finisher. Mm-hmm. And so, they never had the opportunity. And I'm the youngest of five siblings, and so my siblings helped me go to school, and I was first in my family to graduate, and kind of liked this, but I wasn't sure I could pass English or history or math or whatever it at the college level. But once I did, it certainly gave me some confidence. And so I will talk to any student and say, you can do this. So we provide services here because over half of our students are deficient, that we come through our doors, are deficient in either math, science, or English. And predominantly in Oklahoma, it's a math deficiencies. And so we want those students to succeed. And virtually all of them do succeed, but they just have to have a little extra help and a chance to prove themselves. And so,
with all the programs that you have, the educational programs, the partnerships that you've referenced, and so on, you have quite an economic impact on this region. Talk about the economy and how Rogers State University is a driver of the economy in this region.
And that's a great question, Mark. The Oklahoma State Chamber of Commerce, they did an impact study of all the institutions in Oklahoma. And of course, we always like to talk about Roger State's impact on the communities we serve. And the State Chamber, these are not our numbers, but the State Chamber, they estimate that Roger State has a $93 million impact on the little northeast region, and the bulk of it is Claremore, but some in Pryor, some in Bartlesville, but $93 million is a pretty significant
impact.
That's
huge.
And we're a large employer. You know, we'll have... we'll have 100 or so faculty. We'll have about 150 staff, and then we'll employ on any given semester 150 adjunct professors. And so you combined all of that, and then you have the students that come into our campuses each day. Some live here, some commute in, but you take up 3,600, 3,700 students. And so the buying power there, and so we're very proud of the economic impact that we have on our community.
Talk about a return on investment.
It's now a great return.
It's where
about seven to one.
And then in terms of the future, as you consider how this organization needs to develop over the next 10 years, what do you see?
I think we see additional graduate programs. Again, we're only about 20 years old. We have one graduate program. We have another graduate program that's in the making, that's working its way through the approval process. And so more graduate degrees, more online degrees, blended courses where you might come to campus one day a week and take the rest of the hours online. So, and then some totally on-ground courses as well, but more opportunities for our students. And because we want our students engaged, we have to have multiple entry points. People do not want to wait till the end of a semester or the beginning of a semester. So the future, I'm convinced, will be multiple entry points, and then when you master a subject, you go on. You know, and I think we'll always have some cohort of a student that wants to live on campus and have fun and grow up here. And then we have all the other market of the non-traditional students that they may have a family and they may want a career change and they just want to come and get a degree or stay at home and get on online and get a degree. So I think in the future we have to have options that are tied to the job market.
So your career has been quite interesting. You graduate, and you're first in your family. It's kind of a whole family kind of thing, and you get to that point. But as we all know, right, we get to the point, graduation is not a destination, it's the starting line.
It's the start. And you're absolutely right. And let me hasten to say, as I mentioned earlier, my brothers and sisters helped me. I had the good fortune of being the last of five children, and they all helped. And some of my brothers and sisters subsequently went on to get some additional education, but they helped the youngest one first, and financially as well as otherwise, and encouraging and so forth. And so it has been a game changer for my family.
And how did you start your career?
I started in a community college,
uh-huh.
and then a regional, and then a private university, and then a comprehensive university to finish my doctorate. But along the way I worked, in the 70s there was federal money for police officers to go to school. So mm-hmm. once I received a bachelor's degree, I went to work for a police department to get my master's paid for.
Oh.
And then that opened the door for a faculty job here at this institution mm-hmm. as a community college faculty member in 1979. I've been in higher education for about 40 years. Along the way, I had the privilege of serving the people of this area as their elected state representative. And so during those years, I worked, the legislature is a part-time, and I worked at a private university, the University of Tulsa. So I've had a very blessed career with many mentors and many folks that encouraged and helped me along the way. So I really believe, my wife and I both believe in what we do. She's first in her family to go to college, and also her parents did not have a high school education. So we see the firsthand benefits and the value of this thing we call public education, and we believe in it.
Dr. Larry Rice, this has been such a great conversation. You're talking about transforming a life,
yes.
and then lives, and then communities,
yes.
and then whole municipalities. Thank you so much for sharing the story of Rogers State University, of your career, of your inspiration, and thank you so much for your insights.
Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity, Mark. It's a privilege, and welcome to the Hill. So that is our motto, welcome to the Hill, and students are first.
Okay. Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.